This entitled parent is about to say something incredibly racist. This employee is usually pretty chill and lets things slide, but this time, he can't let her get away with it. Happy birthday, today's your birthday, and on with the revamped show. So in college, they had these residential units, mostly filled with freshmen and sophomores, with 4 2-bedrooms off a common area that included a living room of sorts, and a kitchenette with a microwave, 2 burner electric cooktops, no oven, fridge and sink. There was only one building that had these units. It was always assumed it was some architectural students' efficiency design experiment from long before that was built for a grade or something. There were 2 bathrooms in the unit, each shared with 2 of the rooms. So, 2 students to a room, 4 students to a bathroom, 8 students to the collective, and a bunch of these units on each of the 4 floors of the building. There were, however, much better places to eat on and around campus, so the kitchens were largely ignored, save for the occasional cooked eggs in the morning and nuked quick food including popcorn. So much popcorn. Anonymous student A liked tuna sandwiches as they were cheap. He would buy these really huge cans, make up a large bowl of tuna mush, cover it well, important, and leave it in the fridge, and have tuna sandwiches for a couple of days off of the one can. Tuna is tasty after all, so nobody could possibly object. But Karen, in her own mind at least, isn't nobody. So she could object, and she was heard more than once, loudly complaining about the stupid tuna taking up space in the generally empty fridge. Nobody knew what her specific objection was. She just didn't like tuna. It didn't really smell. Tightly covered in a rather cold box, nobody used the fridge much beyond the occasional thing of milk and an odd root beer bottle. Seriously, totally not beer. The labels just happened to fall off, and everybody knows that root beer bottles look like beer bottles. Freshmen like to think they were clever. So one day, anonymous student A opened the fridge to get out the bowl of tuna he had made the day before, and it was missing. He called out, "Hey, where'd my tuna go?" And Karen shouted back, "It was stinking up the place, so I threw it away." Really? It wasn't stinking anything up, and she had never complained about the smell. And that was at least 2 more days worth of sandwiches, so student A was quite ticked. But being a quiet and mild kind of guy, he didn't confront Karen, just sighed and went off to graze on the lawn or something. Now, Karen wasn't above her own canned foods. In one of the cupboards was a motley collection of fruit cocktails, peaches, and other quick and easy foods that could be eaten out of a can. She'd grab one, opened it up, then scurry off to her room to do whatever it was she did in there. And this is the foundation of the revenge. There exists on this planet for some reason, a food called surströmming, a Swedish food. It is fermented herring that comes in a can. In Sweden, there is actually a law prohibiting you from opening a can of this stuff on an airplane. I have been told that a lot of people will put the can underwater before opening it. It is the nastiest, foulest smelling on the planet. Liquid butt smells like newborn baby and lavender by comparison. As fate would have it, student A procured a can from somewhere. It was determined that it was not hard to steam the label off one of Karen's cans and glue it onto this one. And that's what he did. Have you ever heard a 19-ish year old utter an absolute horrific scream, gag, retch in the late afternoon? I doubt anybody told her the trick of opening the can underwater. But then again, she was thinking it was peaches or pears or some other whatever it was. Whatever she was expecting, it certainly wasn't that. A string of predictable, but generally incomprehensible, disgusto babble, along with the lines of, "WTF, what is that stench? What is going on?" Brilliant, hilarious, epic. Except student A didn't realize that the stench would permeate all of the bedrooms, and the outside hallway, and a couple of the surrounding units, and could be smelled outside thanks to the windows that were thrown open faster than you could recite the relevant line in the Night Before Christmas poem. As I said, freshmen like to think they are clever. He took some hate for this from the neighbors, but as for Karen, student A told her what was in the can. Then he told her why he had done it. Then he showed her that he still had a couple more of the cans in his arsenal of stench. No threats were uttered, but threats were definitely implied. Her face went pale and she said not another word. At the end of the semester, Karen transferred to another unit somewhere and was never seen again. But before that happened, student A would occasionally steam off a label from a can of peaches and either leave it in Karen's cupboard, lying loose on a shelf, and in one occasion, did an intentionally poor job of gluing it onto a can of Stinkfish, so it was clearly obvious what it was, even though it had a fruit cocktail label partially peeling off. At the end of the semester, they always had a donation box where students could drop unused cans and boxes of unexpired food that was to be donated to a food pantry or something. So it wasn't just going into the trash. It was noted that Karen had dropped in a dozen or two cans that she had bought, but never opened for some reason. Imagine the trauma your brain would go through every time you saw a new can of food, and you're like, okay, theoretically no one should have touched this, but what if I'm about to experience the worst smell in the world and I can't escape it? No wonder she gave away those extra cans of food. It's just not worth the risk, right? Now this is technically petty revenge, because it was a pretty minor thing that they did, but the lifelong effect that it probably had on this Karen means that the magnitude was almost that of pro revenge. One of my best friends, Alex, was a staffer in a state legislative office. His boss was the head of a key Senate budget committee, so there were always people coming to solicit her support for a particular project or grant or whatever. Someone representing an arts program that was looking for a $250,000 grant is waiting. I'll call her Lobby Ann. She comes up to the reception desk and asks for a pen. The senator keeps giveaway pens with her name on them in stock, reasonably nice ones. So Alex reaches over to the can where the pens are. Lobby Ann says something along the lines of, "Well then the senator will know that I showed up without a pen." So what? She looks across the desk. Alex has some work spread out with his own favorite pen, an expensive one with lapis inlay, and engraved with his name and term of office of a campus organization. Lobby Ann reaches over, snatches it up, and drops it in her purse. Alex, who is a very polite person, is completely gobsmacked, and then tells Lobby Ann that's his personal pen and not up for grabs. Lobby Ann gives him a contemptuous look and refuses, very rudely. One of the sad, funny things about this story is that she uses a slur that Alex was not sure was a reference to his heritage or his perceived sexuality. Oddly enough, given the nature of the stolen object, either slur ended with ink. Alex, confused and deeply upset, sits back down while Lobby Ann flounces back to the waiting area. In a few minutes, the senator comes out to get Lobby Ann. As they're walking past Alex's desk, he stands up and says in a very clear voice, "I'm going to need my pen back." Lobby Ann stops in her tracks, as does the senator, and Alex says calmly, "I may be a slur or a slur, whatever you want to call me, but that pen is precious to me, and you stole it right off this desk, and I want it back." The senator kind of gasps and says, "She stole your lapis pen? She called you a slur?" And then she turns to Lobby Ann, who is frantically fishing around in her purse and stammering something about just borrowing it, and says, "Give it back." Once the pen is back in Alex's hand, the senator says to Alex, "Come on back, I need you," and turns and walks back into her office, leaving Lobby Ann standing there as the senator shuts the inner office door in her face. Then the senator picks up her purse, smiles a big bright smile, and says, "Want Starbucks?" So she and Alex go out the side door and across the street. They could see the front door of the office from the Starbucks. It apparently took Lobby Ann about 5 minutes to realize how bad she messed up, and that she was not going to see the senator that day, or any day. And the project she was going to ask for money toward was probably doomed as well. She'd lined up strong support in the house, so it might have made it through, though it was not the kind of project the senator favored. When she came slinking out, she almost certainly saw Alex and the senator sitting there drinking their drinks. Alex always ends this story with, "That was the best coffee I've ever had." Justice coffee is always the best tasting coffee. Now that pen needs to be framed. The $250,000 pen. It's probably the most expensive pen in the world, except for maybe that anti-gravity pen NASA developed. You just know that Lobby Ann was entitled and thought she was such an important person. Meeting with the senator, gonna do this big deal. And yet she didn't even have the humility to admit that she didn't bring a pen, and that she needed a pen from somebody else. It is natural to be prideful, you know, no one wants to admit a mistake, but here she ended up looking a lot more foolish than if she just admitted that she wasn't prepared and didn't bring a pen. This happened like 30 years ago. When I was a kid, I had a notoriously cheap uncle. They called him Joe Green because he hoarded money so much. Well, Uncle Joe had a summer house in the Jersey Shore, right on the Bay of Wildwood, along with his home in Philly. His shore house was right next to the fishing charter boats, and to make extra money, he would stock up on things like bait, canned soda, lunch meat, etc., and sell it to the guys going out fishing for the day. Nice way to make some tax-free money sitting on your back deck in the morning. One day, my family is down there visiting. I was only like 10 years old and thirsty. I asked Uncle Joe for a soda. Like I said, he had tons of cases stacked up. He told me, "Sure, leave 50 cents on the table." I started laughing and asked if he was joking. He wasn't. I had to pay my uncle to have a soda at his house. Okay, whatever. It just gave us another story to share about what a freaking cheapskate he was. I thought nothing of it after paying him. But my dad felt differently. A few months later, me and my father went on one of these party fishing boats by Uncle Joe's house. After we got back, my dad pulled up to my uncle's house. I told him it was pointless. His car wasn't there. He obviously was in Philly that day. My dad just looked at me and said, "I know." Now, my uncle had a peach tree growing in his front yard. He would brag all spring about how they were coming along and how they were almost ripe. Well, it looked like they were finally ripe. My dad gets me out of the car, grabs a bushel from the trunk, and we start picking all of the peaches off the tree. We literally didn't leave one left. He told me we were doing it because he charged me 50 cents for the soda. I laughed the whole ride home. The next day, my dad split up the peaches. He left a big bowl for us, gave a bowl to my grandmother, some to my aunt, etc. So a few days later, I'm at my grandmother's and she's cutting up the peaches. She would put them in a bowl with sugar on them. It was divine. When my uncle walks in, he looks so depressed and he starts telling my grandparents how somebody stole all of his peaches off his tree. I'm sitting there trying not to burst out laughing as he's saying how he was so looking forward to eating them this year. My grandmother looks up and says, "Here, have some of these. His father just gave them to me." At this point, I'm about to lose it. So he takes a little bowl and starts eating them and says, "They're pretty good, but mine were a lot better." I had to walk out at that point and start cacking up out on the steps. I know it's pretty petty, and I'm sure some will think we were jerks here, but I don't know. Growing up the way I did, that's just not how you treat family, especially the kids. And it's not like we really cost the guy anything. Now, I don't do this often, but I think I'm gonna disagree with the last statement there. He said it didn't cost him anything, but I don't know. If I was looking forward to my peach tree all year, and then somebody stole a bunch of them, well, now if I want peaches, I'm gonna have to buy them from the store, so kinda does cost him something. Was he a cheapskate and a jerk? Yeah, sure. But in this case, I'm not sure if the punishment fit the crime. But let me know what you think. Am I wrong and he got the right amount of justice? Or was it a bit imbalanced? Let me know in the comments below. Background. This is a story about my 18th birthday celebrations. This takes place in India. To make my birthday special, we decided to dine at Barbecue Nation, a really great place. So this is how the place works. There are barbecue grills in the middle of each table and a little flag. When you raise the flag, the staff starts bringing you barbecue on those sticks. Don't know what they're called. And when you put it down, they stop. And you can have a buffet style main course. So since the place is usually full, you have to book online in advance and give vegetarian, non-vegetarian preferences for the barbecue. You could also book the place for special occasions. So in the ancient Vedic systems, there were occupational groups, like the occupations required for an economy to function. These were non-hereditary, and with these systems, every ancient Indian settlement was an economy of its own. But after centuries of social degradation, they turned into the so-called hereditary occupational caste system. So as for me, my ancestors were vegetarian, teetotaler, priest teachers, and I'm a non-vegetarian atheist. Sorry, ancestors. So back to the story. I, my dad, mum, my uncle, and his fiance were sitting at a table. I, my uncle, his fiance are hardcore non-vegetarians. My dad eats non-vegetarian but prefers vegetarian. My mum is pure vegetarian. I and my to-be aunt are atheists, while mum, dad, and uncle are Hindus. None of them are zealots and are very modern and never force their religion down others' throats. We have checked our reservation and settled down, and our conversation is multilingual, switching between English and Marathi. As per convenience, the waiter brings in our initial barbecue. Time to meet the cast. Me, dad, mum, uncle, uncle's fiance, entitled mum, nice husband, nice kid, waiter, manager. The entitled parent, nice kid, and nice husband were on a table beside us, and were fussing over one thing or another since we came. So as I took the first barbecue, chicken I assume, she came over to us and tapped my dad on the shoulder. "I
Excuse me.
Yes?
What is that, may I ask?
Points towards the mutton barbecue.
Barbecue?
Can you please not eat non-vegetarian food sitting beside us?
Now I'm trying to ignore the lady and get some food inside me. I'm starving. When she lunges ahead and knocks it out of my hand. What the?
You ungrateful child. I just stopped you from thinning. You should thank me.
I try to say something, but she ignores me and speaks to my dad.
You shouldn't pass your thinning habits to your child.
Untranslatable no-no word.
He should be raised in a godly way.
Here we go.
Shut up.
Why don't you leave my family alone and get lost? I paid to be here and I'll eat whatever I want.
EM turns to my mum.
As a woman, you shouldn't tolerate your husband thinning. You should divorce him and raise him yourself.
Lady, don't tell me how to raise my kids. This is a free country and I'll eat whatever I want. My mum, the darling she is, almost never swears. Now we had started eating in earnest and very soon the first servings had disappeared, despite her objections. As the waiter came with second servings, she knocked them out of his hand. What an outrageous waste of good barbecue. Now I'm furious. One thing you should know about me is that I don't follow any religion, but am interested in the mythology and history of them all, and have read not just the Hindu scriptures, but also the Bible and the Torah for pleasure reading. If you're so into religion, then why are you spilling food? Doesn't your religion say that food is as precious as the God who created this world? She has no answer to this. Now, nice husband steps in and takes her back amid renewed shouting. He promises to pay us back before leaving and we trust this guy. So we get yet another serving of barbecue, after which comes the funny part. My dad orders drinks for the adults. I was not yet allowed, drinking age is 21, though voting is 18, including uncle's fiance. The drinks arrive, and then EM looks wide-eyed as fiance drinks her alcohol. Before either nice husband or nice kid could restrain her, she comes over to our table and sweeps the glass from fiance's hand. The glass falls and shatters. We were lucky that F didn't get hurt. EM started screaming about how F was a minor and she shouldn't be allowed to drink and tries to slap her when my uncle, who's a big man, catches her hand and pushes her back forcefully. They begin a screaming match. Now F does have a baby face and is shorter than I am, but she certainly doesn't look like a minor as she's just a year younger than uncle. Finally, EM says the magic words.
I want to see the manager.
No, I want to see the manager.
The manager comes and she begins a rant about how my family was corrupting me and how F was a minor, an alcoholic who shouldn't be allowed to drink, and how we had thrown an alcohol glass at her. Now F is on the verge of tears. She's quite faint-hearted. F shows M her ID with shaking hands, and the security footage proved that the EM was talking BS. So instead of paying only us for our barbecue serving, she'd have to pay the hotel for the glass she shattered. When she realized this, she bolted for the door, leaving nice kid and nice husband behind. NH paid for all the expenses while NK apologized. Voicey veterans, this is why we gotta be prepared every single day. If you ain't training, an EM like this could pounce on you at any moment. And what are you gonna do? They're knocking wine glasses everywhere. They're slapping food out of your hand. They're strategically going for our food sources. They know that not eating is our one weakness. Anyway, this one EM seems totally crazy. Most entitled parents are a bit off the rails, but mostly they're just really selfish. With this lady, it's like you want to sit as far away as you possibly can. Alright, keep training my voicey veterans. Remember to speak calmly, defend your property, and live well.
Submit your story to be read on the channel at voiceyhearstories@gmail.com and join our voicey veteran community at r/voiceyhear. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit that bell to never miss an episode. Alright, voicey veterans, I'll see you in the next one.